So many people today asked me where John Henry and I met, and this is the story. Many years ago, before some of you were born, there was something called the witch hunt, the time of the blacklist, the great hunt for reds in our country. There was a committee formed to look for people un-American. It was called the Un-American Activities Committee. Also, there was a senator whose word became law in the land. Everyone trembled. In the government, in the army, in the navy, and certainly in the movie and television and radio studios, Senator Joseph McCarthy cried, "Off with their heads! Off with their heads!" like the White Queen in Alice in Wonderland. But there was not enough reds in the whole country to fill his voracious appetite. So he invented new, wider job descriptions for the reds. I was a blacklisted actor. Ossie Davis was a blacklisted actor. Almost everybody who was worth their salt was blacklisted in those days. At that time, John Henry Faulk had a popular radio show. He was just chatting and telling his stories. He was obviously more American than anyone in New York because he was from Texas. So one day, I knocked on his door with a friend, and I introduced myself and asked John Henry, who I knew was clean and green and from Texas, to run for president of the Radio and Television Union. The current president and his board were blacklisting their fellow actors from the podium. That is, if you got up and disagreed with them, they'd say, "Off with your head," and your name would be put in a book of lists called Red Channels, which was sent to the networks and movie studios, and you would never work again. Well, John Henry did run for president, and he won, and we threw the bastards out. Except he lost his radio show and he couldn't work anywhere. He was blacklisted. So he sued. He spent all he had to clear his good name, and he won that too. He proved he wasn't red and he wasn't pink, except he was controversial. Long after I was back acting, John Henry Faulk wasn't. We're talking decades. You can tell a person's real mettle, not from the good times, but from the bad. And in the worst of times, John Henry flew like a flag. And now John Henry does live happily ever after. Our great-hearted warrior and patriot, great philosopher and humorist. His enemies are in the dust. His friends are many and loyal. And here we all are paying tribute to him tonight. And I'm knocking at the door again, John, because there are other battles to be won out there.
He is my friend, my mentor, my brother, John Henry. You couldn't get me crying up here, and then I won't be able to talk. You'd be here another half hour, me trying to get something out. Bless you. Angels, you have no idea. I keep turning around, Dan, Richard's been going. I said, I don't believe this is all really happening. I've said to Ossie several times, Ossie, you and Ruby and me sitting there in a Second Avenue restaurant, just enough to pay for a coffee, House Un-American Activities Committee coming. It was a long way from there to here, except it ain't, Ozzy. Fight's still on, the same people, still holding tight. And do you know why, beloveds? Because 200 years ago, exactly 200 years ago, a little gentleman about as high as my old sweet boy here got up in Congress and said, I, first Congress, 1789, I have orders from the Virginia legislature to introduce some amendments to our Constitution. And he got up and said, oh, wait a minute, we haven't even got the government going good yet, Mr. Madison. He said, unless we fulfill our promises to the American people today and posterity tomorrow, there might not be a next year for the United States government. The people are very jealous of their liberties and their freedoms, and we have promised them. It's the circumstances under which some half dozen states ratified the Constitution that we would amend it to include a Bill of Rights. And Mr. Madison started, it was 200 years ago, give or take a day or so, to frame that Constitution. And first of all, he framed, my loves, that guarantee that was intended to assure in perpetuity the freedoms and liberties that had been fought for so valiantly in the glorious Revolution. Congress shall make no law respecting the establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, or abridging freedom of speech, or the press, or the right of the people peaceably to assemble and petition their government for the redress of grievances. And Mr. Madison explaining to Congress this remarkable work of art, of genius, said, this contains the people's great rights. This will assure that our sacrifices were not in vain, because we've set up a new society based on the proposition that free people could govern themselves more adequately than any other form of government that has ever been undertaken. This is ours. And he said the essence of this is that the right of censorship shall lie with the people over the government, never with the government over the people. Most of our leadership has forgotten that now, and they're preaching and carrying on about flags and this sort of thing, when the thing that that noble flag stands for is being placed in jeopardy. I had to say this to you tonight, and this, I'm not going to preach to you. Don't get nervous. I'm through. But it's a very, very heartbreaking thing to me to know that so many of my good and dear neighbors don't know what the First Amendment really is, that it's not only first numerically, but it's first in importance. Without it, there can't be those freedoms that those men sacrificed for, the vision and wisdom that they brought looking down through the ages and passed on to us on a silver tray. We did nothing to win them. Now what will we do to protect them? They can't be meddled with, my loves, without destroying the whole thing. As Lee, Ossie, Studs, know so well, there was was a time when that was eroded. It shan't be again. I feel that all of you here are testaments enough to that. I would like to say thank you so much to brilliant Susan Walker and Don Toner, who directed, produced, and really brought us all together. And the Live Oak Theater, a wonderful institution in this town. And most of all, I would like to say thanks, express my deep regard to two people without whom I would never have been able to do my show, my one-man show, and that is my wife, Lizzie. I don't know whether she's back there, whether she's gone now, but bless her heart. And my beautiful and talented friend, Mark Leonard. They made it all. Bless you all. Thank you all. I love you. What? Oh, wait, wait. That's right. Lizzie just reminded me, as she always does, what I'm supposed to do. If I might ask these beautiful human beings standing here to gather around me, we're going to sing the song of an old friend that used to live in my apartment with me up in New York way back yonder almost 50 years ago now. I'm up here in Oklahoma. A young man named Woody Guthrie. This land.
You and me, as I went walking and living the high.
promise you all my love, and you've just discovered my secret. You've just discovered my secret, and I love you all for it, in spite of giving myself away. My friends do all the work, and I get all the credit, and God bless you all.